Hey, I just wanted to jump in front of this episode to give you a little bit of foreground so that you understand what this is about. We sort of got started talking and maybe didn't do a great job giving a good foundation for it. Our dear friend Tim Johnson, a great songwriter here in Nashville, passed away 7 years ago, and his friends decided to put on what's called a pitching party. Usually we go around on Music Row from office to office and play our songs for record executives or A&R, and they eventually make their way onto these records. But all of Tim's friends, after he passed, decided that they wanted to do a pitching party of all his best songs, whether they had written them with Tim or not. We wanted to get out there and play Tim's best songs for people. So what we did was we invited all Music Row, all the big executives, to the Ryman Auditorium to play them some of Tim's music in a night of music celebrating that in hopes that they would be cut by artists. So this was an amazing event that kind of spiraled out of control in a good way, and ended up not just being a couple 30, 40 music executives, but ended up being a sold out show at the Ryman Auditorium. Thousands of people came to hear this and be a part of this magical night. I'm going to go ahead and include a news clipping here that was on before the event, and it gives it a pretty good foundation, and then we'll roll right into the podcast. So enjoy.
Drunks that don't listen, crowds that don't care.
Tim Johnson has a well-known name on Music Row with more than 100 label cuts and multiple number ones. On Father's Day 2010, Tim's life and ultimately his songs took a drastic turn.
He'd had some pain in his side, and we thought maybe it was a gallbladder issue, and went to the emergency room. He was diagnosed with stage 4 colon cancer.
Tim knew his time was limited, so he wrote as many songs as he could.
He was trying to secure our future.
Some songs were extremely personal.
And I had the taste of sweet life.
He even videotaped a message with one song he wrote about his last birthday.
Right before I blew the candles out, she said, "Dad, you got to make a wish." And I just realized that all I really wanted was one more year of everything.
One more year with the ones I love, 'cause they don't make enough time down here on earth.
Tim passed away in October of 2012.
Talking about him in past tense.
But he left a legacy, one his friends are carrying out Tuesday night.
Having his friends kind of pick up where he left off and do the things that he would have done for us.
In what they're calling Honor Thy Song, the world's largest song pitch, artists and songwriters will play Tim's unheard songs.
We're vouching for them as songwriters because we just respect Tim so much.
It was a way to get Tim Johnson on the Ryman stage, where he really belongs.
Megan says she knows Tim would be blown away and can't wait to feel his presence Tuesday night.
I heard this quote, that the veil between heaven and earth gets a little bit thinner. For me, it's when I hear Tim's music.
Hey, it's Joe West from the Rest Barn with
Mike Shimshack
and our great guests today, two great dear friends, Rory Feek and Meg Johnson. We are, we'll fade that out there, Mikey. It's not quite as smooth as like what you would imagine.
I got to get your edit.
And then KTLA.
Yeah.
All right. So we've been thinking about, who should we be hanging out with and talking with? And we're just thinking about great stories and great things we've got to be a part of. And one of those really great consequences of a tragedy that I got to be a part of was the Honor Thy Song pitching party that we did at the Ryman. And I got to do it with these great folks here. And we were just going to talk a little bit about, not only for me, it's like getting to be a part of that is the funnest thing, right? Because like I feel that now, even after all these years, I still feel like, I got to do that. Like there's something about that is like why I do music, you know? So, and I don't know about for the two of you, but, you know, long story short, all of us were dear friends with Tim Johnson, and Meg was married to Tim. And Tim was just one of these guys in town, one of the best songwriters, songwriter by all means. And just one of these guys that whenever you were in the room with him, you had to just, at least I had to swim really hard to keep up, you know? And Rory had sent over, when we talked about doing this, Rory had sent over that little interview from the news whenever they were covering this. And I remember saying something when I heard something that I had said on there. I can remember being in the room whenever I'd be writing with Tim, and he would bring up a whole new concept in a song that wasn't even on the table. It was like, if you were building a house, it was like another addition onto the house of thought. And I just remember, as being a producer and engineer, I wanted to be like great producers and engineers when I'd watch them in the room. And Tim was that for me as a songwriter. Of course, Rory's an incredible songwriter and artist. His story, you know, is an incredible story. But Tim's story was more behind the scenes. And so real quickly, why don't you just introduce yourselves, you know. I always hate to introduce myself, so I hate to put that on y'all. But tell us a little bit about maybe some of the things that were your first, your interactions and your sort of perspective from 10,000 feet as you look back at your relationship with Tim Johnson. Meg, why don't you go first?
Okay. Wow. So, that's a tough one for me because it's so complex, but of course, you know, Tim was my husband and my best friend, and we were like best friends, like right from the beginning, like when we met, like in that brief moment at the Bluebird. Oh my gosh, this is 89, 90, somewhere in there. I can't even, that's terrible. I can't remember the exact year. but anyway, we just clicked immediately. But we were from different worlds.
Yeah. You know, there's such a beauty in those like chemistry relationships, and we don't get to choose them, right? And Rory, you've had this with Tim. It's like, I wish we could choose them. Our publishers would put us with people to write all the time, but very rarely was there magic there, right? But every once in a while, you would get that nuclear relationship where you would say, wow, I don't know what this is, but it's really super special. And you and Tim had more than your share of great songs written together, and you had S1, you had Giant Slayer on S1 over there. What was your, like, when you look back at your relationship with Tim, what was it for you, Rory, that was like different? How did you know that it was different? Because from the outside, when people looked at the two of y'all's relationship, it was one of those like, oh, there's a nuclear thing happening there. What, those guys are better than the sum of their parts.
Well, I appreciate you saying that. It is funny because I kind of learned over time that in some ways, at least for me with Tim, you know, I did get to kind of choose it in some ways, you know, like God has a way, in my opinion, of bringing things together that are bigger than us that we don't see coming. But I always, looking back, I always can see where we had to play a part. And I remember I was at the Boardwalk Cafe and there was this songwriters night that was going on, and I was there with Harlan Howard and some different songwriters were up there, and Tim was one of those guys. I think his only hit that I had heard of at the time was I Let Her Lie. But he was a word guy like I am. He's a story word guy. And he was really, really, really good. And also he was a really good singer. You know, he could have been an artist. He should have been an artist. He's, you know how it is. It's like, technically, was he a great singer? I have no idea what technically even means. But could he hurt you really bad? Could he make you smile a whole bunch? And I just loved it. And so I went back to my office at the time I was writing for Harlan Howard, and I sent, I made a cassette tape, and I sent it to Tim, hoping he would listen to a couple of songs and maybe hear something in my writing that would make him want to write with me. And that was all that I did. And I didn't hear anything for a couple of weeks. And Megan knows this story. We were at a big NSAI award show, and I saw them across the way, and I didn't know Megan yet.
Yeah.
But I saw them across the way, and I went over to say hello to Tim, and Megan just was, you know, it was really a wonderful thing. Cause I was like, I don't know if you've got my cassette I sent to you or not. And he's like, my wife won't stop listening to it. It's in the truck all the time. And that's how we became friends. And we started writing together and dreaming together. And he had certain things. We both had some strong strengths in words and stories and loved country music. And we both had kind of real strong, rough, middle class backgrounds. But he had some things I didn't have. He had an enthusiasm and an encouragement that I didn't have. Like, he had the ability to be able to, I'm not a golfer, but we were on a golf course one day, And I had come across this kid named Blaine Larson, and I was like, he's like 14 or 15. And he sounds like George Strait. And my cousin's cousin sent me blah, blah, blah. And just all in a moment, he's like, yeah, we should just cut some sides on that person and start, we should produce him. I was like, Tim, we're not producers, you know, like we're not producers, we're songwriters. And I remember standing there and him saying, if we say we're producers, they will believe us. And I'll be damned if he wasn't right. I mean, it was, and again and again and again, like, I think what it is like, he might not be willing to make that choice on his own, but he would give you the courage to make it, and he would go with you. And he did it again and again and again. And even now, I think one of my things about where I am and the things that have happened comes a lot from these moments with Tim, to where he was willing to encourage and see something that I didn't see, and changed everything from that moment on, and continues to change it.
And I think he was that for me too. And I think it's funny because I think he was that for everyone he met in town. And Probably. That's why he was such a larger than life figure. He would be the guy in the prison that could start a riot and get you out. You know, he was the idea. He was the genesis of the idea that became the seedling that became the harvest, you know? And he was just a special dude. And the beautiful thing about Honor Thy Song was that it wasn't a benefit. You know, it was the idea of it being a venue to, no pun intended, a venue to get Tim's songs heard, because all of his songwriter buddies believed in his songs. They all believed that those songs, they just needed to be heard, right? So I love that whenever I watched the little video that you sent over from the news coverage, Rory, that, was it Brett Jones that was on there?
Mm-hmm.
Brett was talking about, oh, I'm singing a song I didn't write. I'm just singing one of Tim's songs. And
hey, Joe.
Yeah.
I think you should really go into detail for those watching as to what Honor Thy Song.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Great point. Great point. Okay. So Honor Thy Song was this idea that, and I don't know where it started. Was it you, Rory? Was it you, Meg?
I think it may have been Rory.
It had to be Rory. This sounds like a Rory idea.
Yeah,
where we would have this great celebration of the great songwriter, Tim Johnson, and his catalog. And we were going to go somewhere. We were going to play his songs. You know, we were going to get together. It was going to be therapeutic for all the songwriters. It was going to be this great moment where we could just, everything that was great about Tim, we would get to just roll around in for an hour and a half to 2 hours. So it started off something like that. And in my memory is a little bit foggy. I have memories of us sitting at the Leaf and Bean, I think in Franklin, and having a conversation, but you guys are going to have to fill in a lot of the, you know, my recollection may not be accurate to the reality. What it ended up being was a sold out show at the Ryman Auditorium, which nobody really to this day could explain.
You know what I remember about that is sitting across from each other at that booth. You know, my memories are snippets of that time. It was a bad time for us. It's my family. And we were struggling. We were sad. But sitting there planning that was like such a hopeful, optimistic thing to look forward to. And I can't remember who said, Rory, I think it was you, because you think big this way too. You and Joe obviously both do. But you, we were talking about like the Bluebird or Boardwalk, that's way back in time. Douglas Corner. We were thinking of all these places, and we were like,
these are venues that seat maybe 100 people.
Yeah, if you don't know. Fairness, yeah. And, you know, great places to go listen to live music. And somebody brought up the Ryman. And we're like, we're looking at each other like, ooh, I don't know, the Ryman, that's huge. And Rory and Joe, I can't remember, that part's foggy. It's like, why not the Ryman? Why not? And then it happened. You just did it. You made it happen. It was crazy. It's crazy how that shook out.
What do you remember from that, Rory?
Well, first off, for people who don't know, there is no benefit if you don't know the story. So Tim passed away in 2012, right, Megan? October, what, 17th, something like that? 21st? Is that right? Can you hear me?
Yes, that's
so right. So what day did Tim pass away?
21st.
And so he passed away, and it was something that none of us really saw coming. He was 51 years old. He was really pretty healthy guy, and it came out of nowhere. And it, you know, I guess a year and a half or so, whatever it was, he passed away. And so we left a lot of songwriting buddies, and even more, and he left two children. How old were Jack and Kai?
At his death, they were 12, and Kai was 12 and Jack just turned 14.
Which is a tough time. And then of course he left behind you, but we were also talking about how he left behind this incredible collection of songs that might not ever get heard. And we knew how talented he was, and we already felt like his song should be all over the radio. And, you know, and Tim felt like his song should be all over the radio too, which is right. And so when Tim passed away, we were all thinking about how could we, cause he, as you mentioned in that little article or that interview, Megan, that he wasn't a fan of the idea of doing benefits, not while he was sick and not when he passed away. So how could we do a benefit without it being a benefit? How could we do something that benefits his songs, his children, his family? And, you know, and I think it benefits country music and the listeners because they'll be blessed by him. So we came up with the idea of the Bluebird Cafe. And I do remember my wife and I had the opportunity to play there a lot of times, but Tim, I knew, never had. We were talking about it. It was like, you know, Tim should play the Ryman, and this will be the moment Tim's going to play the Ryman. So all of a sudden it became, just bigger than us. We'll get a bunch of friends together. I know Joe was going to get an amazing band together. You were going to get a list of songs together. And for the most part, most of us, including me, sang songs that I didn't write. You know, they were just his songs. And then since we knew people at the Ryman, I reached out to them, and, you know, I was like, can you let us have the Ryman? They're like, sure. I said, it's a great thing. They said, sure. Do you have $15,000? I was like, this is amazing. They said, you know how many amazing things get pitched to us every day? I was like, yeah, but this is really amazing. So anyway, we did it anyway. And in the end, you know, we had to put up the money to make it happen and invite a bunch of people. And I remember you guys knew some people. It wasn't from me, but I put down the money. But before the event was over, someone that you knew, Meg, had basically paid for the whole thing. Someone from the audience, because people just wanted to step up and make a difference. And
I remember that. It was amazing.
To
my recollection, it was a gentleman who owned Big 98.
Jim Kaufman. I don't know who it was. Somebody you knew, Meg.
Jim Kaufman.
Yeah, and do you know how that happened? Was it just like backstage at the Ryman, he stroked a check like this? I love the idea that, you know, for the movie of what this could be, you know, some guy comes back. But I remember that night hearing like, oh, someone just offered to pay. We had put up equal portions to secure it. I thought it was 18 grand in my recollection, but it was a metric ton of cash. Like, but you know, we all felt really good about it. And then I remember he sort of just came in and just took on the whole expense of it, which was like, it just seemed like this whole thing was like, how often do you get to be a part of something that actually flourishes like this? It was such a good idea. You know, it went from, my recollection was that Bart Herbison was involved for a minute, and he was talking about doing it at the Bluebird. And at that coffee shop, we were talking about, hey, what do we think? And one of us said, it just doesn't feel commensurate with the event. And I can remember us talking and saying, you know what? Even if we only had 300 people in that room, we could make it look super cool. We could put up ropes and have this little section where they almost get to take over the Ryman. And so we were, I think we had expected going forward that it was like, maybe it's just going to be a Bluebird full of people sitting in the middle of the Ryman. But isn't that cool too? Because we get to be in the Ryman and it'd almost be like we had a little backstage experience. But then I can remember being backstage and they kept on pushing the start time back. And I was like, what is happening? Why are they 15 more minutes? And then someone said, look outside. And there was all these people. And I was like, it was almost like loaves and fishes level event. Like, I didn't know where they came from.
I was in the top pew in the very back on the upper level.
How did you hear about it, Mike? Why don't you tell us about how, as like a, just a total outsider at that point, how you heard about it?
I think I just heard about it through social media. Maybe you had posted about it. You know, I had loved Do You Believe Me Now? It was one of my favorite songs that you had written with him. And
with Tim Johnson.
And, you know, and I'd met Tim a couple times at your barn doing the sessions from the West Barn stuff. So I just, I recognized how good he was. And, I wasn't terribly familiar with his catalog. But the idea, and I want to ask you guys, was this meant as a, my recollection is that it was pitched as a giant pitch session of Tim's songs. Is that correct? Or was it more of a...
That's correct. That's correct.
Yeah. Okay. Which is an amazing idea in itself. Like something I had never heard of. I was like, this is a really cool idea. It's brilliant. I never heard anything like that.
The world's biggest pitching party. I think the tag.
Yeah. So, I mean, that's... I think I just heard about it through social media, and it was just one of the most magical things I'd ever seen. It was my first time at the Ryman, too. At that time. So it was,
it was a unique gift too that Tim gave to all of us, is that it was a lot of our first times to get to play the Ryman. So Isn't that funny too? It's like all the good things that I've found in my life that have ever panned out have been somewhat altruistic, you know, doing something for a friend or being a part of something that's a movement. And then you look back and you say, oh my goodness, I got to play the Ryman. I got to be a part of this emotional moment. That whole place by the end of that just felt like, I don't think I've ever been on stage and had more unity with the people that were in the venue than that. It was like, it's a pretty incredible thing just to be in the building for, let alone to be part of organizing, part of being on stage and performing, to get to do that. And then to realize, oh, wait a minute, I did this because I wanted to help my buddy out. But look at all the goodness that came into my life. Everything good in my life has sort of come from that place secretly. You know, it's a beautiful thing to be able to step out and recognize, like, I want to do more of that. I want to be more of those parts. Being a part of the Joey and Rory record very much came because I was allowed to, because I had a barn, right?
Yeah.
Hey,
yeah.
I'll take whatever I could get. And it was like it grew into this beautiful thing that I got to be a part of. So, you know, you don't get to choose. I think the takeaway for me as an adult looking back is like, I got to put myself in the pathway of more of that. I want to be more like that. I want to surround myself with people like that. I love that energy. And it always seems that whenever you give, you do get if you're connected with the right things. And this was a great example of that. I can't, I would say that Ryman holds 2,400, 2,200 in that area.
It's 2,300.
But if it wasn't a sellout, it was as close as it gets. And I don't know how that happens. Do you, either of you have any idea how 2,200 people found out about this?
Yeah. I don't.
Rory?
I mean, we tried to get the word out. You know, we all tried really, really hard to just let people know as much as possible, because it wasn't really for us, it wasn't really about, of course, us just being on stage singing songs. We really knew that the way that it works, because we've lost songwriter friends before, is that they're forgotten very quickly. Someone new steps up and they start singing and doing their songs, and we're like, we want Tim to leave a mark. And one of the best ways to do it was to not only have a lot of people there, but have a lot of industry people there, people who can make decisions. You know, I was just looking. I pulled up the little flyer we made, and the event was May 7th, 2013. So we're almost 7 years exactly from that date. And what's great is you just never know that consciousness. You know, you never know if one of those guys may say, hey, you know, let's think about Tim Johnson for a song. And I think it was really just us all and, Matt, you know, God just getting the word out and people showing up. Some people probably because they knew and loved him, and some people just because they heard it was a cool event that was going to be there. But man, it was amazing.
I played a corporate gig recently, and someone came up to me and told me about that concert, not knowing that I had been involved with it, intimately involved with it. And they told me about it like it was this Woodstocky event, which Which I just thought was like, isn't that cool that it's all, you're saying it's 7 years. I thought it was not that long ago, but sometimes it feels like 100 years. Sometimes it feels like yesterday. But they were talking about this event at the Ryman, like they got to be a part of that. Like, oh, there was this thing and they were telling me about it. And I just listened because I wanted to hear them tell me it for the first time, you know, like as if you were in a songwriting session. I didn't want to step on them and say, oh, I knew I was at that event. But just to hear them talk about it, to see it through someone else's eyes was an incredible thing, to hear their story of their experience with it. And at the end of the day, songwriters and creators should be a part of amazing human stories. We should be telling those stories and living them and finding a way to put them into words for other people, you know, and to be able to be a part of a physical event like that, that did it. Usually there's songs that we get to be a part of. It was just a really cool thing. I wanted to ask you both, and you don't have to answer right now if you don't know. What's your favorite Tim Johnson song? I'm gonna say that mine is To Do What I Do.
That's up there for sure, because I remember this. So the story of that song was I was riding with a friend. And at her barn, she was a professional horse person, and I was hanging out with her and riding some horses at her place. And there was this guy there cleaning stalls, and she introduced me to him. Super nice guy. And he had been kind of a bigwig at a label in Nashville, and there was a changing of the guard, and he was let go to bring in all the new people, and he needed a job. And he started cleaning stalls because he needed to make ends meet. And I went home and I told Tim about him. He's like, you know what? I respect that so much because, you know, you do what you got to do, you know, to get by and to make it all happen for yourself. And if it's not working, you need to be a server at a bar or whatever, cleaning stalls, you know. And then he wrote that song. He just like wrote it. And so the memory of that song is really special to me. And then also, Rory, when Alan Jackson cut that song and we were at the Flameworthies and Alan sang it there, that was a pretty special moment. We were so nervous. the favorite song, you know, I'm torn. There are a couple now. The Apology has always been like one of my most, it has a very deep meaning, especially now. I mean, we can all relate to that song, and I encourage everybody to, you know, for people they love, say it, you know, don't have regrets. And that's what that song is about. Mm. And then, can I say a third favorite?
Yeah. Yes.
What's Stopping You? Because what's stopping you from living your life? You know, is it your inner voice? Is it somebody else's voice? Whatever it is, you know, just address it and move on and just run through the tape, you know, and just keep going. So I hear that song all the time in my head, you know, when I'm feeling fragile or insecure or not wanting to take a risk, that song. So yeah, I mean, it's like I said in that interview a while back, it's like picking between kids, my favorite songs, yeah. But there are definitely some that really stand out to me.
Yeah. For me, of course, To Do What I Do for lots and lots of reasons. I remember when him and I were at Cracker Barrel and he had come in and told me about the song, and he told me that Alan Jackson had reached out to him and said he was going to record it, and he'd written it by himself. And it was like, really? I mean, it was just because Tim's one of those guys. He was that good. He was that good that it could go from, you know, from his mind to his guitar and a work tape to Alan Jackson that fast and find its way onto a record. And then we were all at the CMT Awards. And I remember me and Joey and you and Tim, we were all sitting there. My favorite part was not only that Alan Jackson sang it, but they're in commercial break. And as they're coming out of commercial break, and Alan Jackson and his band are standing there, it's getting ready to happen, Megan leans over to Tim and says, "Can you believe it? Your words are in Alan Jackson's head right now." And Tim was about to throw up. He was so nervous. It was great. And it was a great moment. It was just a you know, we should find that moment, share that moment. On a personal level, I'm pretty sure that song on our Honor Thy Song moment, we ended that night with an empty stool and a guitar and a spotlight and Tim singing that song.
Yeah, the work tape of it.
Yeah, the work tape. And I remember standing at the podium on the side with my wife and just like, crying until I couldn't stop. And I think it was because, first off, it was a great song. It said a lot about all of us, not just Tim. But it was also, we were all part of such a special event that was completely pure. And rarely does that happen. We're really part of something that's just filled with so much goodness. And so that song means a lot. And then there's some other ones. There's a song that on the first tape I ever got of Tim's, it was a work tape. And there was a song called Love is a Gift. And I just loved it. I've always loved it. I still have the work tape. I still listen to it quite often. And when we built a one-room schoolhouse here and we started a board for the schoolhouse and we asked Megan to join the board, we call the name of the board, the name of the nonprofit we have is called Love is a Gift 100% because that song says it so well. One other song, there's so many of them, of Tim's, like I have his whole catalog and there are certain times where I'll just listen to Tim Johnson just because it's so good. But another song that means a lot to me, I actually just went in the studio and recorded a few weeks ago called What You Gonna Do With That Broken Heart. And I always love that song and I love Tim's recording of it. But when we did the event at the Ryman that night, that was one that Megan had on the list. And so I'd never sang it before. Joey and I had never sang it. So me and Joey and Heidi sang it together that night for the first time. And it was just a great song with a bunch of great words about, you know, what you going to do with that broken heart? Are you going to have a good cry?
Punch a hole in the wall.
Punch a hole in the wall. Are you going to drink the whiskey down till you can't stand up at all? Are you going to blame the woman or admit you played a part? What you going to do with that broken heart? And then the next verse says, are you going to find a stranger and have a one-night stand? Are you going to look inside yourself and be as honest as you can? These choices that you're making, they tell you who you are, what you're going to do with that broken heart. But it was just a great song. And then a few years later, so that was 2013, my wife passed away in 2016. And that song took on a whole new meaning for me because I really came to understand that in that moment in particular where I had a little one like Megan, you know, life had to continue on in some form. And the choices that we were making now matter the most. And so it just felt different to me. So I think about it a lot. I sing it in my shows a lot. I talk about that. I tell people, you know, it's these moments that matter the most. And so I just recorded that. So that's a real special one.
You know, it's interesting that you say that. You said, when you were talking, so many things were coming to mind that I wanted to interject, but you were doing it so gracefully, I didn't want to interrupt you. No. I mean, it was like so inspirational to hear you talk. I think that it's beautiful that a song can change over its life. I've been at funerals and I've been at weddings where I've heard cliches that until I was ready to hear them, when I was ready to hear them, they changed. They just sort of disassembled me when I heard them. You know, so it's something about your heart's willingness and where you are at the timeline. And songs are able to do that to us. When we listen to a song, it can instantly take you to a place. It can instantly have a whole new meaning. It can change the way you see a situation or give you purpose. I love that about that. I love that you're an incredible songwriter. You've written some, talking about Rory here, you've written some songs that are like some of my favorites. And yet, time and time again, you reach for what you think are the best songs or the songs that move you the most. A lot of people would say that guy's super justified in just cutting his own songs more than anybody because he's a brilliant songwriter. And you've consistently grabbed for songs that really meant something to you, whether you wrote them or not. And I think that's an amazing testament to you as an artist and as a songwriter, as a creator. It's like, it's really great to see that in an industry where people hunker down with two or three people and write their whole record. and write 7 or 8 records down the road with those same people. You continually, over your career, you and Joey both were picking songs that really moved you. And that's refreshing to me as a creator, because it makes me feel like I can win. All I got to do is write something that really moves somebody.
Well, you know, when I first came to Nashville, I moved here. I made a couple trips, and then I moved here in 94, and then I had to move back to Texas where I was living. Then I moved here finally in 95. And I don't think anybody's really asked that question before, but where that idea came from, I know where it was, is I was in a meeting with Merlin Littlefield at ASCAP. And Merlin was responsible, partially responsible for Garth Brooks coming to town. And he would tell everybody. And he should, because Garth was as big as they came. And he was a big part of that story. But I remember Merlin having this conversation and him saying that one of the special things about Garth was, this is no offense to Clint Black, and he was telling a story about Garth and Clint Black, who were both out at the same time. And that years later, I ended up, you know, working with Clint Black, and he was very good to me. But he said, when Garth came to town, Garth had the ability to co-write with anyone and everyone and only use his own songs, but he made a choice to include other people and to include other songs and to use his platform to bless other people. And it has endeared him to the community. And they were saying at that time that with Clint Black, like, Clint writes every single song, period. He writes most of them with his guitar player, and he doesn't cut any outside songs. And it doesn't endear him to the community the same way. And so I just remember, like, he put a thought in my head that made me think, I was only a songwriter. So I was like, yeah, people should just reach out and record your song because it's the best, Joe, not because, you know, it's the song that I can make the most money on because I own it or I have the publishing on or whatever. And I think by the time that life turned and Joey and I started recording songs and getting an opportunity, that philosophy wasn't just an idea. Like, it's for real. It means something. It means something to me. It's like, I always appreciated when someone would record my song and not their. Like, I love that Tim Johnson's sitting at the award show and Alan Jackson is singing his song. He doesn't have to. Like, how big is that? Like, it's so great. It's so great. Yeah, so it wasn't my idea, but I remember it. I'm trying not to forget it.
What wasn't your idea?
Pick other people's songs.
Oh, it wasn't?
It wasn't my idea.
You embraced it.
I embraced it. Yeah.
Isn't that interesting? Early on, I told, you know, on this podcast, I talked about when you're coming up and you start to have success, or your friends start to have success, there's that thing where you have to make the decision in your heart to be happy for them. The near miss can kill you in this business. And the near miss is actually an indicator that you're right on target. You know, that if all your friends are having success, it's probably pretty good indication that you're right where you should be. But it will kill the morale of a person who is not having the success. And early on, I had to make the decision. I literally, it was like a Y in the road to say, I love this person. I hate that I'm not having it, but I have to celebrate their success. I have to get behind that. And I slowly did that. And now when my friends have successes, I'm bubbling over. I'm fully committed to it. Like, it's one of my favorite parts of the music business, but it was a learned behavior. And I think that's an important thing. Like, when you talk about Tim's songs, when you listen to them and they take on different lives and they'll change the way your perspective is now going on with what you're going to do with that broken heart. You have the power to do that. It's like, you have to make a decision as a creator to do the right thing. As a human being, you have to make these decisions. But what the good news is, it becomes who you are. So even though you didn't come up with that idea, you've embraced it and you've owned it now. And it's you've taken it to another level. You know, whenever I think about you, I love that about you, because you could write 12 songs. It would be 12 killer songs, but you decide not to. And you've always cut these songs, man. I saw you on some TV show with, I don't know who wrote Bible in a Belt. Was that you?
I did co-write that song.
That's an amazing song.
That's an incredible song.
Heart of the Wood, you know.
I didn't write that song. Yeah.
That song kills me, the Heart of the Wood. It's like I have to not cry when it comes to the last verse of that song every time, and I know it's coming every time.
Yeah.
It's a great song. And who wouldn't want to cut a song like that? And I think that's what we need to get back to. That was the idea and the philosophy of, like, if we just showed them Tim's songs, well, then the songs would do the work, right?
Well, you know, it's funny that I think that philosophy is not just in songwriting or recording songs. Like, I think there's, like, some law, there's some natural law in place out there that says, if I make a choice that does not serve me, it will serve me really well. Meaning, it's somehow, it will find its way back around. It will find its way, like, because you're not trying to leverage it and make it work for you. You're just saying, this is going to be good for everybody else. And sometimes I get more excited if I can't see a way for me to benefit specifically. Like, this is not a good thing. I find it in other situations too, where that idea, when you're having a different business decision or life decision, it's like, well, is this good for someone else, better for me, better for them than it is for me? I've kind of learned in time that could probably be the best choice to make, rather than I spent most of my life just trying to get my own. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I felt bad about myself, and I didn't get very far. And then sometimes it feels like if I just try and lift up others more and I don't think about myself, somehow I feel better about myself, and God has a way of pulling me right along anyway. It's a weird thing.
I think you're exactly right. There's so many things that I can't explain, and that we all can't explain, that it's, if you just do what is sort of universally right, you know, what you think is universe positive, right? And if it doesn't suit your interests at that moment, that's fine. There's a beautiful way that it always wraps around. A lot of the biggest success stories, when people talk about a song, they'll pick a song out of your catalog, Rory, or they'll pick one of Tim's songs, Meg, and they'll tell this, you'll get to tell the story about it. But you only get to tell the story about it because it became famous or it had some notoriety. And as I'm telling the stories about these songs, when people ask me them, I realize how arbitrary it is to the other songs in my catalog. You know, I realize, like, this is just, I wish this person knew that it was insignificant that this song is necessarily any better than this other song. Or just, there's such a outside of body experience that has to happen with a song in order for it to reach that level, that there's so many songs out there that just don't seem to make it, right? But the beauty is that when they do get to make it, we place a certain amount of importance on them that isn't necessarily not present in the other songs, you know? I think it's just, you know, you've got to do what you believe is the right thing, and hopefully something right works out. When you look at what it takes to make a song that you're talking about, Rory, or I'm talking about, you have to realize that in and of itself is a miracle. You can't force that up the flagpole. You got to let the universe do it in some way, shape, or form. It just sort of happens. Right. And then you explain it. You explain it like a Monday morning quarterback. And that's a beautiful thing about the music business. It's just, you can't figure it out. You can't figure any of this out. So the sooner you stop trying to, you end up maybe at a better place mentally.
Hey, Meg. Yeah. Meg, I got a question for you. You know, I remember from the Honor Thy Song event, there were a whole bunch of great songs that were being pitched, and I don't know if they've been cut or not, but is there anywhere anyone can go to hear some of these unreleased songs of Tim's?
You know, no, actually, I don't think there is, unless you guys worried, you know, of something, because I still have CDs.
You know, we talked about back then, Megan, we talked about trying to find some like online portal where we could put them. And then it's just, you know, I think the technology's gotten so much better now. That's something we could actually, well, I shouldn't say that, or we'll end up like, that's what our next week will be.
I know.
But it does seem like that should be something that's fairly easy to do, to put
even
them out
a
there.
SoundCloud page, well, or something to that effect.
You know? Let's do this, in lack of a better idea, unless one comes up. If you just rip them and send them to me, I'll put them up in a Dropbox file, and we'll put it down in the link of this, okay. The YouTube video, so people can link to it.
And then, Mike, I'm actually glad you brought that up, because maybe one of you all know the answer to this, which I hadn't really thought about in a long time, but that evening was recorded.
I had already recorded it.
Rory, you
have it. Yeah. I actually reached out to Gabe because I did have some of our friends, I had a team come in and record it. So I reached out to Gabe yesterday to find out where it is. You know, we never did anything with it. So let me look for it and see if I can put it together, because it would be really cool to share that.
It'd be so amazing too.
It'd be amazing. I'll find it.
Live that 7 years later without the heaviness that I had.
How about this, Meg? It would be really amazing to do that and have some of his songs available where you could link through. It's still a pitch session. It will always be a pitch session.
Yeah.
Once we put it online, especially, it could always link to something that people could find songs. And yeah, I love that.
That's a great idea.
That would be awesome. It'd be so amazing. And you know what? It'd be really great for my kids to see that, because they were so young then, and it was sort of a blur, and they weren't a part of the process. They just were part of the audience. And so they don't really have the perspective that they would have now, as they're 20 and 21 now.
I just remember being at that show going, wait, this song hasn't been cut. And then the next, wait, this one hasn't been cut. Like,
you know,
there's so many good songs, you know, like, and the world needs to hear them, you know?
There's so
And you never know, you never know where that will take you to, you know, it's like.
That's true. That's
somebody
true.
Might and find then, it and record it and, you know.
And I can't go without commenting on, you know, I Let Her Lie was, of course, Tim's biggest, his first big hit. I'm going to say it that way. It wasn't the biggest, but it was the first one. It was really a special song to us. It was so many memories attached to it. We met so many people through the period of time I just can't even begin to talk about the experience that song brought to us.
And Daryl came that night and sang it.
And Daryl Singletary, who, you know, was the one who cut it initially, and he came that night and sang it. It was the only song that was sung that night that had been cut before. And he sang it, and Jimmy Nichols played piano, and he had played on the demo for the song. And so he played that night as well. It was just like so many things. And to think of, gosh, you think back on the changes in the last 7 years, you know, just since that night, not just losing Tim the prior fall, but, you know, we lost Joey, and we lost, you know, Daryl, and, you know, it's just to honor that song. You know, it's just like, that is such a great title for that event, because it really is about the song. And Tim used to always say, you know, the song is king, you know, it's what really matters. It's about the song and not necessarily about, you know, like what Rory, you were saying, is like picking the best songs, and Joe, picking the best songs and cutting them, and not just staying within a tribe, you know, reaching, stepping outside and getting great songs that inspire you. And so naming that event, the pitch session, Honor Thy Song, is, I think, perfect. But looking back at the changes that have happened since then, man, have we all been impacted in the last 7 years?
That's incredible. Well, it's incredible to see that it still stands up too. When you listen to Tim's songs, I listen to songs. I've got songs in my wife's. My wife has this CD player in her car that evidently can hold 100 CDs or some incredible amount. So as we're driving her car, these songs, old demos, will come up of things I've written with Tim. And there's some of my son's and my wife's favorite songs that I've written. I take great joy in that. And it's like they still stand up today. When you listen to them, they're like, that's the beautiful thing about a legacy. It's like, if it's really, truly great, it's great 10 years later. These songs are just as cuttable 7 years later, 10 years later, 20 years later. And that's a testament to the work. And I think that was what Tim was all about, was just doing something that would outlive him. I can remember him saying to one of us, I think it was maybe you, Meg, that whenever he found out he wasn't going to make it, he said, I still have a lot of songs to write.
Yes.
You know, like that was, you know, that's where that's, it was part of who he was.
Yeah.
And it was a beautiful event that got to really, very rarely do our efforts end up where we want them. Very rarely are we happy with a creation or a project when we're done with it, or fully creatively satisfied that it could be everything that's possible. So hard to put the period at the end of sentences. So hard to finish a record. So hard to release something and say, this is what I intended to say. And it was one of the few things that I was a part of that when we were done with it was just, I felt like it had sort of gone off and floated above me and just was better than I could have ever done. You know, it was one of the few times that that creative effort was better than what I imagined it could be. So it was a real blessing to be a part of that and super honored to have done it with the two of you.
Oh my gosh, I can't even, you know, going back and thinking about the planning process and thinking this is bigger than me. I can't even get my head around it. But you two had such a huge vision for what it could be. I mean, it may have come off way better than you thought it would, Joe, but I mean, you guys were thinking so big and brave. And I was not feeling brave or big at that time. So I'm so grateful for that. I'm so grateful for that memory. Mm. Yeah, when Tim was finally, maybe like you were saying, embraced the fact that he wasn't going to make it. You know, he had struggled for 2.5 years with colon cancer. I don't think we even mentioned that. He was diagnosed at stage 4 at the age of 50 when you would be getting your first screening. You know, it's not even a time when people are really concerned about it so much, but he struggled for 2.5 years. And during that time, he said, you know, you live like you're gonna live. And he did. And it wasn't until like the very end of his life, like the very end, like the final day or two that we could still communicate with each other, that he said, I've got songs to write. I've got so many great friends. He said, I've got so many great friends. I do not want to leave. Ugh. Yeah. It's tough, man, still. Thanks,
guys. I remember being, you know, just that week, you know, I remember being at your house, Megan, that weekend. And I just, I had never really been around anything quite like that before. And it was like, I remember I had to ask you, it's like, he really does not, you know, he really is holding on to hope, like right into the very end. That was a hard thing for me to wrap my head around. Because I think the rest of us could see that this was not going to go well. You know, I would find that out later on my own, this is how it works on purpose. It's a good thing to hold on to hope that long. But I also remember being with Tim one day and I had this song idea, and this was early on after his diagnosis, and we never finished the song, but he was upset that day. He was like, because he had that song, Live Like You're Dying, was a big song. We were talking. He's like, that's bullshit, man. He goes, the last freaking thing I want to do is go ride a bull for 8 seconds and sky jump. He goes, I want to be around my family. He goes, I want one more day. Like, that's another great song of his.
Yeah.
One more, man. What another great song. And anyway, I remember him and I worked on a song called, it's the reverse of everything that they say. Like for me, and maybe that's not for everybody, but for him, he's like, I want to die living. You know what I mean? I want to die living. I don't want to live like I'm dying. And so we had this, we never finished the song, but he did do it. You know, I think his way of doing that is, I'm going to keep writing songs right till the very end. I'm going to keep trudging along, doing what I do, believing in the possibility to the very end. It was awesome.
It was awesome. I'm going to end this on a story that just came to mind. I was writing at S1 with Tim. We pulled in. We had come out after the morning of, I don't remember where we were in the song, but he looks at the back of his truck and there's a big orange streak on it. And the car sitting next to him in the parking lot. These parking lots at these music houses are tight. They're little gravel lots. They aren't well labeled or well sectioned. Wouldn't you know it? The car right next to him is an orange car. And he's hot. He is hot. And he goes back into the office and he's looking for whose car that is. Going around knocking on doors. And, you know, Tim was, you know, the Oregon in him was up, right? So he was ready to go do some Oregon shit. You know, he was out. And I can't remember. But I do remember... I don't know if you found the guy with that car that was the same color parked next, but I remember that he got a phone call from Meg and he was talking about how hot he was about it and how mad he was. And Meg's like, oh yeah, I did that. at the parking. It had nothing to do with this poor soul that had just perfectly parked next to him. We just happened to have the same color car. And I can't, for the life of me, I can't remember if he did find the guy, if it was during this and he had called Meg, but I was there. And it was just one of those moments that it was just like, man, had he found him, it would just, it would have been even a more epic story of who knows what the, that's just it with Tim. You never knew what the possibilities were. You could either be in a fist fight, you could be hugging somebody. You know, he's like, he pushed you to your extremes, and a beautiful person that I'm privileged to have been a part of his life and the time he spent with us. And he's left a lot of reminders behind with all these songs. So what we're going to do is we're going to try to figure out what it is. We don't know what it is. We're going to figure out some way to link either to all those songs off to the Honor of Thy Song. Even if that's just me putting a link in along with the text for this podcast that we'll let them access via a Dropbox folder. But we're going to try to get you all some Tim Johnson music so you can start to get what it is we've been describing for the last hour. And an hour goes by quick, doesn't it?
Does.
I'm going to try and put together the video too, so that at some point we could share that also.
Yeah, that'd be great.
Hey, I have a funny quick story to tell Rory. So my kids sang on Jesus Loves You as part of that.
Is that right?
With Joe. And so every time my studio's in the basement. I'm in my basement right now. And so every time I go down to work in the studio, my kids will say, you know, yeah, why don't you go do that so maybe one day you too might win a Grammy.
There you go. That's all it takes.
They're like, the very first time we even sang on a record, we won a Grammy. This is easy.
They need to stop right now.
Yeah, they need to stop. Yeah, exactly. They need to stop. It only gets worse.
One exactly. For one. I'm out.
One for one. Yeah.
My dad.
Tell your kids, thank you for me.
Yeah, please. Of course. No problem.
My dad beat me arm wrestling whenever I was getting older, and he had a tough time beating me, and he never arm wrestled me after that. He knew when to get out. They need to get out. And I'll show you this right here, guys. This is, I made this. Me, Meg, Tim, and the kids, we went to the Franklin factory, and we all took out, you know, some piece of ceramic. I don't know if we didn't actually make the cup. We just painted them. But all these years later, I still have it. As you can see, I've drank all of the paint off of it over the years.
That's great.
Hopefully it's not lead-based paint. But every time I see this, I think of you and Tim and that day at the Franklin factory. I want to thank you both for being on. Would you want to say something, Meg?
No, I was just going to say, I remember that so vividly. We were painting, I had a huge bowl, and Tim, we were all painting it together. On the bottom, we've all signed it. And it's on my paper right now. Included.
Hey, Meg, how are you doing? While we're here, we're touching base. It's been 7 years since then. How are you? How are the kids doing?
You know, we're good. It took us a while to bounce, for sure. You know, the kids out of high school and in college now, well, actually remotely in college now because of, you know, our world we're in right now. But, and I'm doing well, you know, working. I'm a real estate agent now. And that's, I've been very, very fortunate and blessed to be in a great market. So that's sustained us well. And yeah, we're doing okay. You know, it's our new normal, you know. We miss Tim like crazy.
Yeah.
Every day.
We all. He's one of a kind.
Yeah.
Thanks, cool. Joe, for the memory, for reminding us of the memory and getting setting up an opportunity for us to talk about it. This is really fun. Yeah.
Thank you. Isn't it fun to relive? I mean, it makes me smile. Yeah. You know, it's like you think about what can make you smile, the power of a smile. It's like the smile is just you sort of overflowing with the memories of that, you know. So it's good to be a part of that. Thank you both for letting me be a part of it way back when. And it's just a special thing. We're going to try to get more clips up of it, maybe a couple video clips and some music for you all to hear and let you all see what we're talking about here with the great Tim Johnson. So thank you all for being on from the West Barn, and we'll see you next time.
Thank you all.
Take care.
You guys. I appreciate you all, you know, writers and attendees coming here and working on your passion for songwriting. It means a lot to me personally. Appreciate all the teachers, especially come to Santa Fe. I know it's not any fun for you. So
great fun.
It's awful.
Proud to be
it's
here.
Terrible.
This is all very proud to be here.
Well, that's good to have you. So anyways, the song goes out to you all. Well, I've been a waiter, a refrigerator clerk,
I've shoveled manure until my pride hurt. And you're starting now. It's all part of the work. Do what I do. I've been evicted for not making rent. Made my daddy wonder where my good sense went. For the price of a dream, my years have been spent to do what I do. Sit here tonight with a six-string guitar to be what I've always been in my heart. Just for the chance to play you my song and the thrill when I hear you singing along. It's been worth everything I've been through to do what I do. Well, I played for empty tables and chairs, for drunks that don't listen, and crowds that don't care. Been told countless times, you ain't going nowhere to do what I do. So I hope the critics and the skeptics alike all bought a ticket to this show tonight. Well, they'd see firsthand I have survived. And what doesn't kill you makes you more alive. And I'm one of the fortunate few who do what I do. There's so much joy this music can bring. So I count my blessings when I step up to sing. Cause there's so many people that would do anything to do what I do. And I thank all of you to do what I do.